सेमेस्टर वी आर गोइंग टू डील विथ हाई एनर्जी फिजिक्स, ठीक है? सो दिस इज द टॉपिक दैट आई एम गोइंग टू टेक. इट हैज़ गॉट अ क्रेडिट ऑफ 3, सो इट्स इन योर इलेक्टिव सब्जेक्ट हाई एनर्जी फिजिक्स, PH 152. ओके, सो वॉट हैपन्स इन दिस सब्जेक्ट राइट नाउ इज लाइक द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट पार्ट इज इट हैज़ गॉट अ लॉट ऑफ थ्योरी थ्योरी. सो समटाइम इट गेट्स अ बिट बोरिंग, ठीक है? But that's why I prefer to make more PPTs, okay? I started making the PPTs, but it's not that every time we will be making PPTs, because there are also mathematical derivations to this. So whenever we are doing some mathematical derivation, we'll do it on the board, else we'll prefer doing a PPT, okay? In PPT, I'll also prefer using audio video, okay? So that we are interested in the subject. Today, it's just an introductory class. That means we are going to talk about what is the current research that is going on in high energy physics, okay? Probably a rough estimate on what are the scopes if you study high energy physics. Sadly, not much scope in India, okay? So this is the topic that we are going to deal with in this session. But before we start, we need to know what is the syllabus that we have, okay? So this is the first time that you are being taught the high energy physics in NIT Nagaland. Before that, this syllabus was not taught, okay? So this syllabus is just approximate, okay? As time goes on, we might just try to modify it here and there, okay? If you want something interesting to know, then we can also include that in the syllabus, okay? So let's take this as a trial basis. Now, some of it we have already learned. Actually, if you talk about high energy physics, it's nothing but particle physics, okay? So particle physics we have already studied. So we want to deal more with particle physics, but in more detailed way. But when we talk about particle physics, it's also important that we learn a bit of history. So that's why I'm saying that sometimes it becomes boring because there is a lot of theory, you know. So what I'll prefer is I will put the points on the slides, okay? We'll put this recording also, and we will also, I'll also share the PPT with you, okay? So that you can make your own notes. I prefer you read in exam writing your own notes, but I don't know how much you're going to follow because you also have major project this time, okay? So in case if you are going to save time, I think this might help because we have a PPT. You can directly read from the PPT and come and sit for the exams, okay? So that might help, but I prefer you don't do that. Try to make some points on your own also, okay? So we will have a mix of audio, video and typical chalkboard classes, okay? So just make that point there. So the first unit, we will actually talk only about elementary particles. But here we will only talk about production and detection, okay? So before we start with the production and detection of elementary particle, we should know the model, right? So we have got standard model and quark model. Quark model in the last nuclear physics classes in your third sem, I have not discussed in detail. We have only talked about quarks, but not the model, okay? So it's basically a hexagonal model structure, okay? That's what we are going to discuss. And the standard model we have already discussed, but we are also going to include some more details into it, okay? And probably a bit more of Yukawa-Mason theory, a bit more on why it is called strange particle and so on. Then production and detection. So the thing is, how do we actually produce these elementary particles? Okay? So this is just like a story. Yeah? Okay. Kya hota hai? You have the elementary particles and you know there is up quark, down quark, charm, strange, top, bottom and so on. But how can we produce them? Is it that easy to produce? In fact, no. Okay. If it's a heavy quark, it's very difficult to produce. Okay? In fact, it might have been produced only during Big Bang. So whatever the accelerators are doing nowadays in Geneva, CERN and all, they are basically trying to mimic that. Okay? And they are not at all successful because a lot of things has not been achieved till now. In fact, standard model is not a total success. There are a lot of doubts in it. Okay? So we're going to see that also. Then what is the unit? In unit which we measure, okay? And what are the classifications? Classification, I think we don't need to really go into it because we already have classified it a number of times, okay? And then we definitely need to know what are the accelerators that are being used, okay? And then we have got colliding beam accelerator and all the different kinds of accelerators and all, okay? But if you look into this, interaction of charged particle, let me just take a marker there. Okay, so if you, it's not coming on screen. Yeah. So if you look into this interaction of charged particle and radiation with matter, this is something which is very basic. What does it mean? That I have a material, okay, and I have got some kind of radiation falling on it. Let's say some kind of electromagnetic radiation, right? Let's say visible light, infrared, UV visible, and so on, right? So based on that, you have got some kind of spectroscopy, UV visible spectroscopy, photoluminescence, infrared spectroscopy, and all. Why exactly we are getting an output from there? We have an input, some radiation falling on the system, and we have got some kind of output in the form of absorption, radiation, and so on, okay? That is because these radiations are actually interacting with that matter. So in the same way, what happens when these elementary particles interact with matter, okay? Or the nuclear particles interact with matter, so something similar. Then detectors of single charge particles, shower detectors, and calorimeters, okay? So these shower detectors and all, you already have a basic idea because we have already studied about nuclear detectors. Okay? In the next topic, we have got quantum electrodynamics. So these things might sound very hi-fi, okay? Lag raha hai, bahut hai. Quantum chromodynamics, electrodynamics, sab padhayenge, okay? We are going to go along these things and we are going to see here something which we have done, but I will still try to repeat this because this is also important for your NET exams. Okay? Because this is specifically quantum electrodynamics, but this is put into nuclear physics. Okay? So if you look into this, electron proton scattering, very important, okay, weak scattering. And then we've got proton form factor, elastic electron proton scattering. So this will be some of numerical problems, some derivations would be there, because we're also going to talk about form factors, you know, probably we'll use the board for this, okay. Next we have got the quantum chromodynamics. Now as the term chromo suggests, it's basically dealing with colors. So if you consider a quark model and you've got up, down, charm, strange, top, bottom, all these are actually nothing but categorized into another category called colors, okay, sometimes called flavors, okay. So we are going to see that in that way, and we are going to see something which is called quantum chromodynamics, okay. But we are not going to go too much detail into the quantum side, okay. We are going to do some derivation, we are going to use the wave functions and all, but we are going to only check the derivation and not too much into quantum mechanics. Electron positron annihilation to hadrons. Now we already know about annihilation, right? We have heard about the term annihilation. But we are talking about annihilation to hadrons. So we are talking about in terms of elementary particles. Okay? Then quantum chromodynamic correction, there are some corrections. And then we are going to shift to weak interaction. We have already talked about weak interaction, but we have not gone into any theory till now. Okay? So there are some theories, VA theory, nuclear beta decay, neutrino quark scattering. Okay? There is a term which is called Kebibo angle, the angle at which it is getting scattered, weak mixing angle. And of course, we are going to revisit CP violation. Because if you remember in our last semester, we saw that in weak interaction, the CP violation is actually quite prominent, okay? But we did not discuss that in detail, okay? Next, unification of interaction. Now this should interest you, okay? Because I have a term which is called elements of string theories, okay? And I have something which we call it as the grand unified theory. By the way, syllabus, it's very fresh, okay? Abhi abhi oven se nikla hai, as fresh as pizza, okay? So I preferred using these kind of topics, okay, because these are more into the latest part of high energy physics. Because reading a typical 90s or 2000 syllabus is all about old theories of elementary physics, and that's why I have also included something like present experimental status. So this is something for which we are not going to get a book. Present experimental status. So probably we are going to see on the some videos. We are going to see some findings on some research paper. We are also going to see something from the CERN website. Okay, these things I have already found out some content. Probably we can see that today. Okay. So one more thing I'd like to tell you. Whatever I am presenting on the board or on the presentation, this will be a part of your syllabus. Okay. मेरे को old age syllabus नहीं पढ़ाना है. Okay. So that way you will be updated, right, with the syllabus. But what happens is, if you talk about particle physics, or if you talk about more specifically about high energy physics, there is something which is, the branches are, there are a lot of branches, okay? Something dealing with astronomy, something dealing with quantum mechanics. So I have tried to include everything a bit, okay? Particle physics initially I have included, then I have included quantum chromodynamics and quantum electrodynamics, but there is also astronomy. And that's why the last topic is introductory cosmology, right? Interested in cosmology, right? Yeah. I think after Kishore sir visited our campus, we are more interested. So I thought, okay, let me include a bit of this also, because this is also a part of the syllabus, okay? Because some of the institutes are taking high energy physics in India, and they have entire syllabus based only on astronomy, okay? I think Tejpur University has a syllabus which also deals more with astronomy, okay? In high energy physics. So I've included this, but this doesn't start without Hubble's law and expanding universe. Okay, there is a basic theory on this, and then we have got some equations, cosmic microwave equation. The cosmic radiation you have already studied. So based on this, we have got something which is cosmic microwave equation. Okay, and then nucleosynthesis. Okay, in the Big Bang. So this is basically what's happening at the beginning of the universe. So we are also going to see some timeline there, and then baryon, antibaryon, asymmetry. Now this baryon asymmetry is an aspect which is not covered in the standard model. So this is a drawback of the standard model. Okay, so this is something which you are also going to see, a bit of dark matter. I'm really not knowing that what exactly I'm going to teach there, but definitely we are going to do something over there. Okay, very simple. So this is our syllabus, and the books I prefer you take up with Introduction of Elementary Physics. Okay, Introduction to High Energy Physics. I hope you know your sources to get the books. Okay. So these two books usually have most of the topics, but every now and then we are going to see the internet to find out more information on that. Okay, is the syllabus okay? Okay. You have a 3-credit syllabus, so we have got the 3 classes in a week. Okay, so I think only one class is at 8:30. I think it's at 8:30. We'll check the routine. Not today. Today it's 10:30. We're just shifting the class. But yeah, we have one at 8:30, other two at another 10. So we should be perfectly fine. And what happens, you know, is if we study using a PowerPoint presentation, the syllabus goes a bit fast. Okay? So we will try not to make it too fast. Let's discuss things, look into things. Sometimes I might tell you to note something. Okay, so that is important. Okay? So if you look into this topic, this is as per University of Colorado. Okay. For the introductory lecture, I have not taken up something from pure textbook. Okay? So what they say is that high energy physics is known as particle physics. Okay? So particle physics and high end physics goes hand in hand. Okay, very important. Because you know, when we talk about particle physics, we are going to generate something as quark. We need a very high energy to generate it. If we don't need a high energy, why we need a setup like CERN, which is around 27 kilometers in circumference, right? That's the reason that we need to accelerate it and get maximum energy and do a kind of collision, let's say proton-proton collision, and try to see if we can generate those quarks and all those things, okay, black holes and all. So this is all dealing with high energy. Like you and me cannot design it in a lab, okay? So that's why it's high energy physics. So if we want to know high energy physics, what is our aim? Our aim is basically to find out the fundamental building blocks of matter. So we know that initially it was electron, proton, neutron, and then it became quarks and so on. But still a lot of understanding has to be done. We don't know even if there are more fundamental particles into it. Okay? So it's not totally answered. We have a lot of findings to do. And it is also important that how do these particles interact? Why in every interaction there is no strange particle generated? Why up and down actually generates a proton? Okay, and so on. So these interactions need to be studied. So what is the most fundamental thing that we know is the standard model. So this is basically the theoretical understanding or the theoretical construct based on which we actually design a model, and we assume that whatever is included in this model constitutes the fundamental particles, right? But that's not true, because standard model also has got some drawbacks. And the interactions we already know, which are actually included in the standard model, strong force, weak force, and electromagnetism. But here also one more drawback comes in, because we know that the one more interaction is gravitational force, but that is not included in the standard model. That means the standard model is not sufficient, because if you consider the scale of the universe, the gravitational force is something which we cannot ignore, right? Comparatively it might be less, but we cannot ignore the gravitational force. Everything around us exists because of the gravitational force. But that is not included in the standard model, so this is also one of the drawbacks. So in exam, if I am asking you a question, note down the drawbacks of the standard model, probably a 3-mark question, at least you should write down 6 points on that, okay? So if it's an objective question, write down only the points, else you can just describe some points, okay? So what exactly is happening in the field of high energy physics right now? So right now, people are trying to understand that what happens at higher energy, corresponding to smaller distances. Now if you remember in your nuclear physics, we told that the nuclear force will act only up to a certain distance. Beyond that, it is no more attractive, okay? the gravitational force comes into effect, the electrostatic force comes into effect. If it comes too close, again the nuclear force is not effective. Correct? So that's a problem. Now what happens? We may produce new particles, okay? So these are the further studies, okay? So sometimes if you like in future, if you are going to study or do some research in high energy physics, probably these are the topics you are going to work on. We may actually produce new particles, which we still don't know if it exists. We can identify discrepancy in the standard model. Already some discrepancy are there. If you can answer that, you are actually up for a Nobel Prize, okay? Because a lot of things has to be done there. Then we need to investigate the existing array of particles in more depth, but at lower energy. Okay, so we need to know that what happens to the existence of these particles at lower energy. And this is a study which is beyond the standard model. It doesn't deal exactly with standard model, it's beyond the standard model. Okay? So what kind of result, the result that we get can give us a better understanding of what exactly we are going to do. So this is interesting. How the universe works. Do we know how the universe works? No, right? Because people claim, scientists claim, and it's actually true, that only 5% of the universe is known. 95% is unknown to us, okay? Out of which some are dark matter, some are dark energy. We're going to talk about dark matter and dark energy at the last unit, okay? We're going to see what exactly do they mean by dark matter and dark energy, which can be detected, which cannot be detected, and so on. So how the universe works, very difficult. Now Higgs boson, when it was discovered, the year, remember? We discussed a number of times last 2012, right? So it's quite late, it's very, like, it's almost in the recent news, right? But it's not included in most of the syllabus, okay? So we have the Higgs mass, but Higgs mass was detected to be very, very low. It is also one of the reasons why Higgs bosons were not detected earlier, okay? So why the Higgs mass is so light? That answer is not yet been found out, okay? Next, what is dark matter made of? That has been an age-long question, okay? Still people are searching for that answer. Then the question is, are all the forces unified into one force at high energy? So that means the gravitational force is not there. So if you consider the higher energy, can we really say that the gravitational force is also included? If it is included, how? Okay? How do we exactly talk about the grand unified theory? Okay? So these are some questions that are not yet answered. One more question is, what happened to antimatter in the earlier universe? I'll just revisit one story that I have already told you. Okay? If you take 10 coins, flip it. Okay? What are the chances of getting heads and tail? Might be there will be more heads, less tail, more tail, less head. 50-50 chances are less. But if you take 1000 coins and start flipping them without any biasness, the possibilities are that it will be almost 50-50. 50 heads, 50 tail. You can do that experiment, okay? It's a probabilistic experiment, okay? More mathematical in nature. But you can do that experiment, take a coin, flip it 1000 times, you'll get 50% time you'll get head, 50% you'll get tail. Okay? That is what is happening. Now imagine you are flipping the coin, okay, and you are using some kind of force. Let's say on one side of the coin there is a magnet connected, okay, and we have got a magnetic field. Then all the coins might flip into head. So what is going to happen? Out of 1000 times we are going to get head. The question is, if there was antimatter and matter at the beginning of the universe as per a lot of theory claims, why is it that today we are only realizing matter and not antimatter? Where did the antimatter exactly go? Is there a parallel universe? Do I exist at the same place but made of antimatter? Okay, so those are the questions. Where did they go? So the one more, that is also a theory, that there was some kind of force similar to this coin example which actually made all the matters existent and all the antimatter non-existent. Okay? But that's just a theory, people doesn't know that. So these kind of questions are also need to be asked, and what happened to the antimatter in the early universe, okay? So this is a sum of the questions and etc, etc, and so on, okay? So we have a number of questions there. But these are some of the most important questions which the scientific society is currently asking. So accelerators producing energy are not seen in the Big Bang, okay? So what happens is, basically accelerators are also producing particles, okay, elementary particles, and we are not really sure whether they are seen in Big Bang or not. Okay? it's there, it's existent, okay, but during Big Bang did it happen? We still not don't know because it's not mimicked as yet. And natural sources of high energy are used to explain the nature of matter, okay. So what are the sources of high energy particles? We are going to see that production and all. So there are some natural sources which are being used to explain the nature of these matter. Now where are the works going on in the current location? Please remember, this is not the first unit because I started with quark model. I have not gone to quark model till now, but this is included in your syllabus. Okay, if I am teaching this in the class, is there in your syllabus? Should know these things. Okay, important. So this is the collider detector at Fermi Lab. Okay, we usually call it CDF. This is one of the best labs in the world for high energy physics. If you're working there, career sorted. Okay, nice set. Okay, so it's basically in Chicago. Okay. And the CDF basically has achieved many important results, but one of the most important results was achieved in the year 1994, 26th of April. Okay, it's basically a collaborative project. A single country cannot actually finance these kind of projects because this is huge in nature, okay, enormous. So they have announced the first evidence of the top quark. Nowadays we know there is top quark, but it has to be found out someday, right? It was found out in 94. At this CDF. Okay. In 2006, it was again important because another kind of meson, basically the oscillation part of B meson, was considered and found out. What happens is if you have got an elementary particle and if it is traveling a long distance, there is some kind of oscillation that sets in. That is also difficult to detect. Okay, and that oscillation will also tell us a lot about it. Okay, what does oscillation exactly mean? Think about the black body radiation. In basic quantum mechanics, why did quantum classical mechanics fail? Why did quantum mechanics came into the picture? What was the basic idea of this theory of black body radiation? That you have basically got a system, the radiation enters the system, it is not able to escape because there is a pinhole there. Okay, it gets lost, so it absorbs that radiation. Okay, and when it basically radiates the energy, it is radiating. It's radiating, but it's discrete in nature. It's not giving out all the energies. What is the reason? The theory was that there were some oscillators. Okay, the body is basically made up of oscillator which oscillates, and when it oscillates, it will give out some kind of energy. Okay, so the basic idea is if we have got a charged particle, and if it moves or it oscillates, it is definitely going to give out some kind of energy, electromagnetic radiation. So even if you consider something as meson and all, and even if it has got slightest of charge, consider something like a proton or neutron, we know it has got charge, okay? Because neutron as a whole is neutral, but it is not neutral in its pure sense. Why? Why neutron is not neutral in pure sense? It is wrong to say that neutron is purely neutral. Because it is made up of quarks, and quarks have got charges. The total is neutral. It's not neutral, okay? So we've got two down quarks, one up quark, right? That is the neutron component. So it has got charge. So basically when it moves, it should radiate some kind of energy. That is the radiation that is coming out. So that means this movement oscillation needs to be studied to know what kind of radiation is coming out of a system. Okay. This is the ATLAS. I think this is the most famous one, right? ATLAS you must have heard about number of times. Okay. If you look into the full form, it is basically a toroidal LHC apparatus. LHC means Large Hadron Collider, right? So it's basically a collider system, and we know it's a hadron collider, okay? So we know what are hadrons. Anyway, we're going to see that again. So it's called a toroidal LHC apparatus. So ATLAS, A, toroidal, T, okay? And you can see apparatus, AS, okay? Or L, LHC, L. So you remember what is a toroidal thing? What do you mean by toroid? You remember solenoid? Yeah, like a donut, right? So you've got a solenoid and you've got a toroid. So you know what is a solenoid, right? You have got a core and you've got some wire windings on top of that. So that is basically in the form of a cylinder. Now if you bend the cylinder and join both the ends, it will become a toroid, toroid, right? So basically that's the reason it is called a toroidal structure. Now if you can look into this, okay? If you look here, see this is basically kind of a toroidal structure. But it's huge in nature. So what are its major findings? So it's basically one of the seven particle detector experiment constructed in the Large Hadron Collider. There are seven particle accelerators. Okay? ATLAS was one of the two LHC experiments involved in the discovery of Higgs boson in July 2012. So Higgs boson The discovery of Higgs boson is credited to Atlas. Okay? And it is designed to search for evidences of theories of particle physics beyond the standard model. So this Atlas actually challenges the standard model. Okay? We're going to find out more things on this. Sometimes even the slightest of machinery problem shuts the system down. Okay, and the research stops then there. Then it again it starts after some years, after some repair and all, take time. These kind of things. Okay. This is closer to us, Japan. Okay? So this is the super Kamiokande. Okay? This is basically a neutrino observatory at Japan. These are all nothing but a part of a supercomputer. Okay, this is all the part of a supercomputer. Okay. And this is basically 1,000 meters below ground. Okay. Now since I'm putting this on YouTube, this video, and I'm taking images from the internet, I cannot put anything without credit, okay? Because everything has got a copyright. Okay, so these are all the websites. So if I'm sharing this with you, if you go to these web pages, you'll find more details about it, okay? So if you're really interested, you can directly go there and check it, okay? You don't have to Google around, okay? So this is actually one of the three or four supernovas. So, okay, this is not a part of this, but exactly when does it detect the neutrino, okay? So you know supernova explosion, right? So what is basically supernova explosion? Yes. So it's basically a burning of a star, or you can say it's a stellar explosion, okay? It's a stellar explosion. So there are only one, three or four supernova explosions that happen in our galaxy every century. So in your lifetime, probably you might see two, maximum two supernova explosions, heard about two, okay? We don't put much interest into it because we are not into that field of astronomy, right? So these are actually super energetic events that release neutrinos at the speed of light. At that time, neutrinos are released, okay? Here on Earth, we are struggling, okay? Nature, it's like natural. Chalo, neutrino aise release kar denge, tum logo ke liye. Kar lo experiment jo karna hai, okay? So what is this setup there in Japan? It basically has got a computer system to monitor the real-time arrival of these mysterious particles. It basically monitors that. Because see, neutrino, okay, high energy particle, very less mass. So it's very difficult to detect, okay? Something like cosmic rays we have studied in our lower classes, that it doesn't affect our body because it doesn't interact with our body. If it doesn't interact, how are you going to detect it? It's difficult, right? So the thing is, you have to set up a system specifically for that. So this is the detector that we have, and it can offer crucial information on the collapse of stars and the formation of black holes. Okay? Because supernova and all, everything are related with black holes. Okay, formation of star is not a part of our syllabus right now, but this is more or less basic in nature. Okay, we already know that. We have got two more setups. One is called T2K and Bell 2. Okay, so this experiment is also set up in Japan. Okay, this is basically the inner view. I have got an exterior view also. I'll show it to you that later. It is designed to study the properties of B mesons. Now, what are B mesons? These are heavy particles containing a bottom quark. Okay, so these are mesons, no doubt, but it has got a bottom quark. If you look into the list of elementary particles, we will see that bottom quarks are there, okay, which makes up some of the elementary particles, some mesons. Okay, but you have not studied that in detail. But now probably we will go into these details. Okay, so that's important. Okay. So this is the T2K experiment at Japan. Okay, so what does this T2K experiment does? It basically shoots neutrino. Okay, Japan is like, if you go from one coast to another coast, it's around 295 kilometers. Okay, so this shoots neutrino 295 kilometers across and underneath Japan from east coast to the west coast. So can you imagine the setup? 295 kilometers underground, Japan has made that setup. That much of progress is going on there in high energy physics. Okay, so we have that. Now what happens? The neutrino was actually detected at the beginning from one coast. At the east coast it was detected, okay, near the point of production at the east coast, and then it was again detected 295 kilometers away by using that supercomputer, okay, that we have, the super Kamiokande. Okay, so we have that. Then what is the reason? Because I want to see the type of neutrino oscillation. As I told you, if it is traveling a longer distance, it is going to oscillate in nature, okay? And that oscillation needs to be studied to know what kind of radiation it is giving out, how does it behave, and so on. So if you detect it on one end and detect it on the other end, you can study the behavior and know the oscillation. So it has to be a setup of 295 kilometers long, okay? Too long. So the goal is to this. Now if seen, Now, if it is observed, the oscillations, we can see a whole new set of experiment related to physics of the highest energy scales and earliest time of the universe will begin. So this is what happened at the beginning. 295 kilometers is very small distance. If you're talking about Big Bang, it is considering light years distance, right? So that means the oscillation has to be even more massive. Okay, so if we can study this much, we are actually going to understand a lot about the universe. So the question is, do we know a lot about universe? The answer is no, right? We exactly don't know a lot of things about the universe, right? So we will stop here today because it's time. Okay.